Hey, what's up? I'm DJ Sixsmith. You're watching The Sit-Down. Thanksgiving Day Parade is coming. Keltie Knight's going to be there for entertainment tonight. What's up?
How are you? Hey, how are you? Thanks for having me.
Gotcha. Good to have you in New York.
Yeah, I know. It's exciting. It's cold.
It is a little cold.
A little different than LA. Anyway.
What a great time to be here. Yeah. So what are you most excited about with the parade?
I love the parade. It's my fifth year hosting with Kevin Frazier, and we are like the funniest, most ridiculous two people on the planet. And the show never stops. If we're in the makeup room, if we're hosting the Thanksgiving Day Parade, if we're on Entertainment Tonight, it's always the same. Like, we just have this amazing chemistry and this friendship that is so deep. And so when we get to do these big events together, it's like, I was just with him this morning, and we have such a good time. So I think what we're excited to see this year is the fact that Miranda Lambert is our special guest on the parade. Nice. I love country music. I grew up in the country. She has a brand new album, and so she's going to be performing two songs. One of the songs is called Settling Down, and it's about her new husband, who she met here in New York City, where we are. He was a New York City police department. I guess like an officer, I think he might be a supervisor.
Gotcha.
He was outside one of the morning shows, and she was walking in, and they caught eyes.
Wow.
That's how they met. So this is like a full circle moment for her in New York City and us. And I think the biggest thing we're just really watching right now are these winds that you've been having in New York City. I don't know, like the crosswinds.
Yep.
And so those cause major issues with the big balloons during the parade. And so each balloon has its own sort of wind watcher meteorologist that like has a wind meter with them, and they see what these crosswinds are at and if they need to pull the balloons down, if the balloons will even fly.
Right.
The last time the balloons didn't fly was 1971, so we've been on
a really good streak.
Yeah, so we're just hoping that that we have a good Thanksgiving parade.
So what have been some of your favorite memories of doing the parade the last few years?
You know, for me, it's I grew up in rural Canada and without fancy Hollywood parents, and then somehow made my way into this job. And I really feel like when I look out and I see the parents lying in the streets, and yes, the big balloons and the celebrities are so fabulous, but when you see like Spirit of America cheer or these amazing marching bands from schools all over the nation, and you know the hard work that went into those kids fundraising to be here, keeping their academics up, rehearsing like crazy, the local newspapers that would be like, we're sending our kids to the Thanksgiving Day Parade in New York City, like it's such a big deal. And it's cold and the parade route is long, and you see the pride in these kids' faces to say that they got to perform in this parade, and that every year really, really warms my heart, because I'm also freezing cold because we're out there for like 5 hours. But I just think that's a really special thing that New York City gives these kids, and no matter where they go, if they end up being Lizzo and playing the flute professionally and winning Grammy Awards, or this is their senior year in school and they're never going to touch an instrument again, like this is just such a special memory for families. And I always have special guests every year. I had my family from Canada last year. I had family from London the year before. This year, my makeup artist's, longtime makeup artist's son, William, has been asking to come to the parade. He's been too small, and this is going to be his first
year.
Now
he's old enough. He's very
old. So I'm like going to love seeing the parade through his eyes. I mean, I'm working the whole time, so I won't really actually be spending any time with him. But have a great parade, William. I hope you enjoy it.
What would be the biggest surprise that people don't realize about the parade? Because it's one thing to watch it on TV, but I feel like it's a totally different thing to experience it live.
I think just how big the balloons are. Like,
They're monstrous.
Well, you see them flying, and you're like, on TV or the pictures growing up, and you're like, yeah, that's cool, that's cool. And then the Pillsbury Doughboy or the Red Power Ranger, like, comes down, and they're as far, you know, maybe from me to this curtain or me to the other me, and they're so close to us, and you just can't even believe that this is happening in New York City, and that's what makes it so grand, and that's what makes it so exciting, and that's why millions of people from around the world come to line the streets of Fifth Avenue to watch this parade. It's just mind-blowing.
Yeah.
How are you even doing this? And it's just so exciting. And I feel like in a world that is constantly filled with bad news, this parade is a little bit of a break from that. It's just so festive and happy, and it's just amazing.
Speaking of that, what's it like building out Entertainment Tonight? Because you mentioned there's so much stuff going on politically and a lot of bad news in the world.
Yeah.
What's it like to just be able to focus on celebrities and like all the crazy stuff there?
Well, they have their own kind of bad news.
They do, certainly
For sure. There's always a breakup and a divorce and a, you know,
or a meltdown somewhere.
Or a Kevin Hart car accident. I mean, God knows we cover enough sad news on ET. But I think for me, I really look at it as I want it to be an escape. I want our viewers to spend the time with me every night and get to just laugh and feel like even though there it might be a mom and she's cooking dinner and she's doing laundry and she's dealing with 100 things and feels so uncool and she's been wearing leggings and a ponytail for like 6 days, like that we can still bring a little bit of glamour and fabulousness to their lives. And that's why I love to focus so much on our good work stories, which is when we go around the world with celebrities and how they give back. And I focus a lot on fashion because I love fashion and I'm wildly uncool. So I love to just see what the celebrities are wearing. And I think there's something dreamy about seeing these red carpet looks and being like, yes, I hated that $10,000 Dior dress. Oh, it was horrible. Like, meanwhile, I'm wearing leggings. You know what I mean? There's just something so fun and it's really an escape. And we do share a lot of sad news and hard news, but there is that level of excitement. And I was just at the American Music Awards on Sunday night and I was there and I think I had the coolest moment of the night.
Let's hear
the viral moment is a Shania Twain moment, which we can talk about later. But the coolest moment of the night, I was on the platform and I had Billy Porter from Pose, who has, of course, stolen everyone's hearts on this show, but his fashion is next level. So he was wearing this crazy Tom Brown cape and this like ridiculous hat. And then I turned to my side and there's Billie Eilish, like music wonder kid. Yeah. And she's wearing this like beekeeper hat that was Burberry and it has all these sequins. You can't even see her face, but I'm like, I know that's her. And so I had Billy on the platform and I turned and I grabbed the other Billy and I introduced the Billies together. It was Billy Squared. And then right before that, I was interviewing Billy Joe from Green Day. So I actually had three Billies.
Lots of Billies.
It was just so cool. And they had never met before and they were like gushing over each other. And it was just, it was so fabulous. And I love that kind of moment. It was when you can connect these celebrities that maybe are too shy to go up to each other or don't know each other and make a moment. And then the whole world gets to watch.
Or haven't met each other before and yet they finally cross paths at a moment
so
like this.
It's so cool. Let's talk about the Shania moment.
All right.
So Shania Twain closed the American Music Awards with this medley. She's going to Las Vegas. She's doing this residency. It's going to be amazing. So she came on the carpet, and I asked her about Taylor Swift winning the Artist of the Decade. And Shania gave this beautiful, beautiful answer about, you know, how talented she was and what a great songwriter she is. And what she said was, you don't have to be beautiful to be a songwriter. And then the internet cut it off right there. And then it went viral because everyone thinks that Shania has shaded Taylor by saying, you don't have to be beautiful to be a songwriter. And it has 2 million views on Twitter right now. I'm getting retweeted in every second minute.
But the truth
is, there's more to the clip. There was more to the clip, as you know, in what we do. People are always editing it. She went on to say, you don't have to be beautiful to be a songwriter, but the way she is beautiful and she holds her beauty with such grace and she's a powerhouse and such a phenomenal woman and I love her so much, is what she actually said. But the internet is a cruel place,
it's rough.
They've cut it off, and basically they've cut it into this little clip where it looks like her being like, yeah, she's great, and I mean, she's proof that you don't have to be beautiful to be a star.
That's brutal.
It's so bad. I feel so bad for Shania because she's getting reamed, and like she was nothing but lovely, and it was like one country queen to the next, you know?
Well, Taylor Swift is such a polarizing figure, so I think anything Taylor-related is going to get buzzed. Why do you think that is? Why does she pull people in all different directions?
I think... my personal opinion that I'll probably get in trouble for saying is I think that the world is still a little bit scared of powerful women. And so I think that she alienates people because she started as this like cute little blonde plaything that was like just singing about love and writing her songs. And then she's become this global force. And she is someone who is greatly aware of the power that she holds. And she uses that power to, like what she did this year with her record deal and with Spotify, she uses her power to actually better the entire community. She has so much power in the music business that she's making changes for contracts that will affect the person who's playing for three people at an open mic night and having their songs on Spotify. You know, she uses her clout and she knows her power, and I think that that really freaks people out. I also think that she's an easy person. Sometimes when you're such a big star, my mom always says, like, if you don't have haters, you don't matter. Because when you get to be, that's when people are mean to me on the internet. I'm like, well, my mom said.
Thanks, Mom.
But I think that, you know, when you get to be so big, the level of haters rises with that as
well. Absolutely.
So she's an easy person to hate because she's so talented. She seemingly has it all. But I think, people really, you know, I think she's great. And I really love her new record. And I love that she's in love. And I love to sing the lover song to my husband in the kitchen. And I sound terrible. I mean, that's what I've got. But I also want... One of the things that I really try to do on Entertainment Tonight is remind everyone that they're like actual humans behind these celebrities.
Exactly.
I love to read a magazine and hear a tabloid story and gossip as much as the next person. But like when we gossip, we have to do so at such an elite level because we have to make sure what we're saying is true. And that's, I think, what E.T. does a little differently is we make sure that everything is vetted 500 times before it comes out. And we don't want to like ruin anyone's lives with our information.
No, of course not. Even the fact, the way that she leaned into her music this year and saying, like, if I was a guy, this would be celebrated,
yes!
but I'm a woman and this is a totally different story.
Yeah.
Like, that's somebody taking control of her own story.
Yeah.
And some people just don't like that, but I totally applaud it. It's a great thing.
I think it's great. I mean, you know, I don't know about your bangs, but, like, live your life. You know what I mean? Like, I liked your hair when it was long, but everyone has an opinion on everything.
To each his or her own,
right? Yeah, exactly.
Why don't we talk about movies? Because...
Oh, yeah, so we're getting ready for one season.
I saw Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
What'd you think?
I loved it. Thought it was great.
Yeah.
What did you think of it?
Do you think, well, first of all, I have never loved a Tarantino movie as much as I love this movie.
The last 30 minutes are insane.
Yeah, it's so crazy. But I think that at the Oscars, if I was to make, and we can talk about it during award season again, I think you're going to see Little Women, which I just screened.
It is really good, right?
So good. And I was like, oh my God, I got to go see this adaptation of an adaptation of a movie of a book. Like,
but they stacked the cast. I mean, come on.
The cast is. I mean, it is next level fabulous. And I'm laughing, I'm crying. It is everything I want it to be. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood will be at the Academy Awards. I think we could even see Brad Pitt getting nominated for supporting. He's so good
in
this movie.
You gotta put him in there.
I mean, he's so good. And then there's like a ton of other movies. Like we had The Goldfinch at the Toronto International Film Festival, which got so, the critics hated it, but I still think it's such a beautiful movie that it could be in there. But I think, I think it's going to be such a fun award season because I think we're going to have a Leo Brad bromance award season where they just come to everything together and like are each other's dates to everything. And, you know, I would say like Brad Pitt is one of those people that no matter who you are on the planet, when you see him, you're like, this is a movie star. And that's what makes it so exciting. He had two movies this year, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood and Ad Astra. And him just being at the premieres, you just see him walk down and you're like, this is a magnetic human being. Like, I love that he's back. I love like seeing him. And I also think that Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, we might have a cool story with the little girl in that movie, Julia Butters.
Great. Yeah.
So she was so good. And there's talk about her becoming a supporting actress nominee. So she would be a super young supporting actress nominee. And the other big story I think of award season is like, will Jennifer Lopez get nominated for Hustlers? Did you see Hustlers?
I did not see it, but I mean that whole thing would be that would be incredible.
It would be so good. She was fabulous.
Yeah, that's what
I heard. The movie is campy and it's not a typical Oscar movie, but remember that Melissa McCarthy was also nominated for her role in Bridesmaids.
Right.
So this isn't out of the world. She really was so good as Ramona in this movie. The amount of care and practice that she went to perfect her pole dancing work. I took class on ET with her pole dancing instructor.
Gosh.
It is so difficult, like crazy. So I think it would be fabulous, and I think J-Lo has the best fashion in Hollywood, and so I would just, I mean, she often just shows up to the Golden Globes to present because we're like, we need some glamour.
Like, why not? We need a star here.
Bring Jennifer in her dresses, you know? But like the fact that she would be able to come this year as a nominee, I definitely think we'll see her at the Golden Globes, but my fingers are crossed for her for the Oscars.
Well, I think the Oscars are realizing we have to bring in these movies that are reaching all these audiences, like Black Panther
last year.
You know?
Yeah, exactly.
But at the same time, there is going to be a certain type of movie that wins. Like Green Book obviously fit the narrative of what's going to win, but the fact that we can even have a conversation about Jennifer Lopez being an Oscar nominee, like that shows where we're at in 2019 going into 2020.
I couldn't agree with you more.
Good deal. Keltie, really nice to meet you.
So good to see you. Thanks so much. Congrats on everything.
Thank you. Check her out. Thursday's a big day on Entertainment Tonight. She'll be rocking here in New York City. For Keltie, I'm DJ. See you next time here on The Sit Down.